Father, as we look to your word tonight, we thank you for opening up the eyes of our understanding. Thank you, Lord, for flooding us with light. Father, thank you for using this message to take us up to a new level and walking in what you've already provided for us. In Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. All right. Praise the Lord. You can open up your Bible this evening to Hebrews chapter number 4. Hebrews chapter 4 and verse number 1 and 2. We're going to look at those passages again tonight as a follow-up to Sunday morning's message. I want to kind of give you a little update here on a few things. One is next month, for the Oasis Network, there is going to be a support days, they call it, spring support days. So like the first few days of the month of March, they encourage people that listen to their program. If they want to donate and be watchmen and be partners with their ministry, they're welcome to do that. And so I get this phone call from the station. They said, you know, we give out gifts whenever this happens. And so, like, if somebody calls in and makes a donation, they're able to receive a gift. And, you know, we have Kenneth Copeland on the list. We have Billy Brim on the list. We have Lynn and Kathy Mink on the list. And we want to see if we could put you on that list. I go, really? I go, okay. And so I go, well, do you have a sermon? I mean, have you found? They go, yeah, we've already gone online. We found a sermon that you preach called God Will Prosper You. And as I heard them say that, I go, yeah, I don't think I ever preached a sermon entitled that. Yeah. I go, oh, yeah, you did. You know, we found it online. And it's funny, they found it on a Wednesday night when I hadn't finished up chemo yet, but they found this sermon. So here I was up there, you know, bald-headed Tom preaching away. And they heard it and they said, oh, yeah, we like it. And so it's kind of funny. In our weakness, how many know God is still strong? Amen. I didn't even remember I had spoken that. So that's coming up, and I'm excited. You know, it's kind of a blessing. It's a neat thing. And so as we're talking tonight about mixing God's word with faith, mixing faith in the word of God. I'm actually going to read this to you from the King James Version. So Hebrews chapter number 4 and verse number 1 and 2, it says, let us therefore fear lest a promise being left us of entering into his rest, that any of you should seem to come short of it. Notice verse 2, for unto us was the gospel preached as well as unto them. Now he's talking about the Old Testament saints. I believe he's specifically talking about Joshua and Caleb. They heard the same message that the 10 spies heard. But the 10 spies didn't mix it with faith. It says, but the word preached that we had the same gospel preached to them as was preached to us. It says, but the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. Now, I know Sunday morning I went on for quite some time just keying in on this whole idea that we've got to mix the word of God with faith in order for it to profit us, okay? So how many of you were here Sunday morning? All right, let me back it up. How many of you were not here Sunday morning? Okay, well, there's a few of you. It only takes a few for a preacher to get motivated, you know. But so the gospel was preached to people, and it didn't benefit them because they didn't mix it with faith, okay? So Joshua and Caleb had the same exact message that the other 10 spies had. And I think sometimes we fail to realize that when they picked out all of these spies out of each one of the tribes we're talking about in the book of Numbers, they got a leader from each one of the 12 tribes. So they really kind of cherry-picked out the biggest, the best, the smartest, the brightest. We want a good representative to represent the tribe. And they went right through every single one of those tribes, and they picked out these different people. And they gave them all the same message, and the same message was that God has given us a land. Let's go take the land. Well, you know the story, how that 10 of them, 10 of the 12, came back with what was referred to as an evil report in the King James. The ESV says it was just a bad report. But it was a report of unbelief. And the report was this: we're not able to take the land. And there's giants in the land. There's a lot of problems in the land. And so we're not able to take the land. So 10 of them came back with a bad report. 2 of them had a different spirit. And the different spirit they had was Joshua and Caleb's spirit. And they said, no, we're able to take the land. Matter of fact, let us go up at once and take the land, for we're well able to take the land. And he said, really, they're nothing. They're bread for us. Let's just go take the land. So what the writer here of Hebrews is saying to us is we've got to remember that you can have two groups of people that hear the same message. One person mixes that message with faith, and it profits them. But you have another person that heard the exact same message, the same everything, but they didn't get a thing out of it because, see, they didn't mix what they heard with faith. Now, it happens in church. I mean, you know, you can have two people come to church. One person comes to church and they say, boy, that was really a good message. That was good. Did you get something out of that? But, you know, there's another person and they heard the same message. They heard the same everything, but they didn't get anything out of it. Y'all, it's not just hearing the word that causes us to be blessed. The Bible says in James, it's when we do the word, that person is going to be blessed in their doing or in their deeds. So tonight, what I want us to do is just once again think back on how can we step it up in the area of mixing faith with the word of God. How can you live with a higher expectation? Now, I believe one thing that will happen is when we get to heaven, all of us are going to spend time with the Lord, and we're going to realize how much vain repetitions go on in the body of Christ. You know what I mean by vain repetitions? It's kind of like praying, and we're really praying kind of a prayer, but there's not a lot of expectation mixed in that prayer. Lord, we just pray you'd help us today, and the Lord's going, great, I'm right here to help you. Do you understand when all the promises of God are yes, and they're amen to the glory of God by us? So whenever we hold up a promise to the Lord, there's never a time the Lord looks at us and says, well, I don't know about that. All the time, 100% of the time, when we hold up a promise to the Lord, his response to us is yes and amen. Amen means so be it. Yes, I'm right there with you. So this evening, very simply, I want us just to stir ourselves up to where we have a higher level of expectation. Jeremiah 33:3 says this, call unto me, and I will answer you, and I will show you great and mighty things that thou knowest not. Call unto me, and I will answer you, and I'll show you great and mighty things that thou knowest not. Now, in the Amplified of that same passage, you know, I don't know if you realize this. This is a side remark. Did you know the Amplified has gone through a revision? So now there's two Amplifieds. So you have to look for the Amplified Classic Edition if you want the old school version, okay? So I hope this is the old school version. We'll find out. Call unto me, and I will answer you, and I will show you great and mighty things fenced in. This is it. Fenced in and hidden, which you do not know. Now notice this. You do not distinguish and recognize and have knowledge of. So God says, call unto me, listen to this, and I will answer you, and I'm going to show you some things that are fenced in, things that are hidden, things that you do not know, you do not distinguish, you do not recognize, and you have no knowledge of it. Things that are not on your radar. I got something for you that's not on your radar. Well, one time, several years ago, at least 5 years ago, maybe longer, I was listening to a sermon by Willie George. And Willie George tells a sermon, told in this sermon, how that one time in the night, God gave him a dream, and he saw what was later known as the Christmas train going around the park there, the Camp Dry Gulch. And he said, I saw this train going around Camp Dry Gulch. And I knew it was a Christmas event. And he said, I saw all this happening. And then he said, I heard the Lord speak to me after the dream and said, if you do what I tell you to do, by the end of this year, you will reach 50,000 people with the gospel. And he said, you know, I had this camp, and that camp had been sitting there, and the slowest time of the year was typically going to be October, November, December, January. You know, those months were some of the slowest times. And he said, there the Lord spoke to me in a dream and said, if you'll do what I tell you to do, you'll reach 50,000 people. This won't be the slowest time of your year. Actually, this is going to be the busiest time of your year. So, you know, the Lord showed him this, and he tells how he just pretty much did what he saw in the dream. He went out, and he said, I can remember when we opened up for the very first time this event up in, you know, outside of Tulsa, Pryor, Oklahoma. He says, when this event opened up, he said, I can remember when the first train came by, I literally had to duck down behind a prop because we were working right up until the very first train came by getting ready for this. But the idea was, he said, this scripture became a real reality to him, and that is, there's some things that God has for you, but they're fenced in. They're hidden. You do not know them. You can't distinguish them. You can't recognize them. You have no knowledge of them. Now hear this. Is it conceivable that God has some things on his radar that are not on your radar? Is it conceivable that God has a way of opening up opportunities for you that you've just got to be open to him? You've got to have an ear that hears. You've got to have ears that hear what the Holy Spirit is saying. How many know we need to have big ears to hear from God? We need to say, Lord, I'm listening to you. This morning I was reading the story of whenever Jesus told the disciples in John chapter 20, when he told them, cast the net on the right side of the boat. Well, you know, it would have been easy for the disciples to go, look, we've fished all night long, right side, left side, it doesn't matter. But if Jesus says right side, you need to go right side. If Jesus says do something, you know, he's not just moving his lips. He has something to say that we need to know about. So here's what I want us to see tonight is that I want you to live with expectation that God can open up things, and there's things in your future, and there's wisdom out there, and there's unclaimed treasure out there, but we've got to open up the eyes of our understanding in order to reach in and grab that. Correcto? Have you ever heard about the fellow that have you ever heard or read about the gentleman that God gave him the idea for insulin? It's a Canadian doctor. You want to read that story sometime. Go online and read it. I can remember reading that. He said it just came to me like as a burst of inspiration. I believe he was even asleep, and it just came to him. And it was like, this is it. You know, many medical breakthroughs have come, I believe, from the Lord. I know one thing, they didn't come from the devil, okay? Because he's not out trying to help people have a higher quality of life. It's the enemy. So, back to Jeremiah chapter 33. Well, I heard Willie George teach this message, and I thought, you know, that's so fascinating. And I thought, well, I'm going to start praying that prayer. Jeremiah 33:3, call unto me, and I will answer you. And then I thought about fenced in things, hidden things, things you do not see or do not recognize. And so I was putting that before the Lord in prayer, And I was praying one morning early, and as I was praying, I said, Lord, if there's anything out there that's fenced in, things that are hidden, things I can't recognize, don't distinguish, don't see, let me know what it is. Now, I heard the Lord say this. Here's what he said. He said, Operation Cold Water. I heard that. Operation Cold Water. Now, you know, I heard that and I thought, now that's, I'm sure somebody else has already come up with that idea. You know what we all do when we get those thoughts? We go to have you ever heard of this thing called Google? Have you ever heard of that? You know, well, I immediately go to Google. That's got to be something I've heard somewhere. And I think I'd heard about, I'd never heard of it personally, but I think I Googled it out and there was some type of Coast Guard training or something. They called it Operation Cold Water. That was the only thing I could find. But here's what the Lord reminded me of. The Czech festivals coming to Oklahoma City, The Czech festival is coming to Yukon, Oklahoma. In one day, the population doubles about it doubles from about 25,000 up to about 60,000, more than doubles. And it was like the Lord said, why don't you just set up a booth and give people cold water as they come by and just call it Operation Cold Water. And on some days, the Czech festival, it's chilly. But on that particular day, how many know the Lord even knows the weather, right? And the weather was nice that year. It was actually warm. So I had people in the church donate bottled water. Donate bottled water. So we had pallets of water stacked up, water everywhere, water. And we ended up that year going out. And whenever people would come by, we'd just say, hey, do you want some water? We had a fellow put together a little thing that said Operation Cold Water. And we'd just give people bottles of water. And I can't tell you how many people looked at that and said, that's a great idea. And of course, every time they'd say that, I go, well, it's Jesus. He's got a bunch of good ideas. You know? And, you know, we'd give out that water, and people, thought that was such a neat idea. How many know God is a lot smarter than people are? Do you realize that? And what we've got to do is realize that God says there's things out there that are fenced in, things that are hidden, things you do not distinguish or recognize or have knowledge of or understand. But I have knowledge of those things. Do you get that? Okay, I'm on a roll here, so I might as well tell you another illustration. Well, you know, on these radio programs, the longest portion of my radio, when we do this radio, the longest portion is I do a 25-second intro and I do a 20-second outro. So for 25 seconds, I usually start out with a question, and then on the backside, I will make some wrap-up summary. Well, I tell you, that'd take me forever. I'd type those out, and, you know, you got to get exactly 25 seconds. You got to hit exactly 20 seconds on the back, you know. And Wes will tell you, well, you need to speed it up a little bit. So, you know, it's kind of a challenge to talk for just exactly 25 seconds and just exactly 20. How many know you can't cut it off in the middle of a sentence either, right? So, you know, one day I was thinking, boy, you know, I've got to get those put together. And the thought just came to me, and I know somebody said, well, Pastor, I would have thought of this a long time ago. Well, I didn't, okay. But the thought came to me, why don't you just let the last line be, join me for part one, join me for part two, join me for part three, join me for part four, join me for part five. In other words, it has the same first part, but then I just add a last line there, and then Wes records all those. We splice them in, so Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, you know, we just put all that together. That was one idea. Now, I know some of y'all, I know that. Some of you have said, Pastor, I would have thought of that months ago. And even Wes, who works in radio all the time, said, Tom, I don't know why I never thought of that. But do you believe that the Lord has some ideas that he could give us, and one good idea from God could change our life? You believe that? I mean, God is not short on creativity. God's not short on wisdom and understanding. And so tonight, when I'm talking about mixing your faith with the Word of God, I'm talking about there's some areas that relate to your work. There's some areas that relate to your marriage, to parenting, to your health. There's things that relate to every part of your life that if you will just put this before the Lord, Lord, I'm expecting you to expand me. I'm expecting you, Lord, to help me see some things that are fenced in and hidden, things that I don't distinguish and recognize and have knowledge of. I'm asking you, Lord, to show me those things. And you're living with a higher expectation. Now, what we say sometimes is faith will put a demand on the promise of God. Now, sometimes when people hear that, they kind of, you know, they're kind of set back at that as though, you know, we're kind of too forward or too aggressive in our faith. But the idea here is that the lady with the issue of blood, the power of God was there for everybody. Everybody who had faith could have been healed by touching her. But there was only one person who had a spirit of faith, an expectant spirit, that she reached out and said, if I just touch the hem of his garment, I shall be made whole. See, she had something that the rest of the crowd didn't have, and that is she had an expectancy. She had a a faith, a spirit of faith about her to pull on the anointing. Now, we have to do the same thing. We have to have that spirit of faith and that expectancy, and that is, we're going to put a demand on that. We're expecting to receive wisdom. Thank you, Lord, for filling me with the knowledge of your will and all wisdom and spiritual understanding. Colossians 1:9. So we're going to pray those prayers, and we're going to have an expectation. So tonight, I want to ask you a question. Are you really mixing faith with the promises of God? You need to be around people of faith, because what will happen is when you get around people of faith, they'll give you some ideas on how to use your faith or how to live a life of faith in a whole nother level. That's why we need to be in church around people of like precious faith, so you know that we kind of iron sharpens iron, and you know, it spawns us, it encourages us, it provokes us in these areas. Larry Hutton made this statement when he was here last year. I listened to the CD. I wasn't here that Sunday, but he shared how that one time he was having some problems, I think it was with his leg or something, and he said the Lord just dropped one thought into him that just changed the whole, we call it a paradigm shift, when you think completely different about something. And he said the one thought the Lord gave him was, Larry, at what age does my word no longer apply? Isn't that good? In other words, you know, because if you listen to most people, they'll say, you know, your body's just like a car. The more miles you get on it, the more it's going to go wrong. But, you know, there only is one thing different from our car than our body. How many know our car didn't get redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ? My car didn't get redeemed. I mean, Jesus didn't hang on the cross for my car. You realize that, you know. But he did hang on the cross for our body. And the scripture does tell us in 1 Peter 2:24 that by his stripes we were healed. And so there's a redemptive part of what Jesus did on the cross for us. So, you know, one statement that Larry Hutton made was, he said the Lord just put it in his heart. So at what age does my word no longer apply? Or what age, we'd say it this way, does my word not work? Do you realize the word's going to work whether we're 25, 35, 45, 55, whatever it is. God's word still works. So what we have to do is start mixing faith, mixing it up. Mixing it up. What does that mean? That means you're expecting, you're living with this attitude of, I'm expecting, Lord. I have a spirit of faith. Now, that's what Joshua and Caleb, we're going back to Joshua and Caleb now, Numbers chapter 13. So that's what they had. The gospel came to them, but it also came to others. And what they did was they said, we're well able to go up and take the land. Let us go at once and take the land. And, of course, you know the story, that of that generation, everybody who was 20 years old and up, they were forbidden to go into the land. The wilderness really wasn't a journey for them. It was the destination. They died in the wilderness. But everybody 19 and under showed you the mercy of God. And God said, you know, you will go in, but these older ones that should have known better, then there's going to be penalized. They're not going to go into the land. And the thing that the Lord said to him in Numbers chapter 14 and verse number 28, if you could put it up on the screen, Numbers chapter 14 and verse number 28, here's what God said will be the determining factor for those that go into the land. As I live, declares the Lord, what you have said in my hearing, I will do to you. Now, personally, I like the NIV of that one. And the Lord says, and as I live, says the Lord, listen to this, surely as I live, declares the Lord, I will do to you the very thing I heard you say. Now, I don't know about you, but that could be a negative. That could be a positive. I'm going to do to you the very thing I heard you say. Well, if you're saying the right stuff, you go, boy, I love that scripture. Do you love that scripture like I love that scripture? But, you know, people that are saying the wrong thing, they'll go, can you go to the next scripture, please? As surely as I live, declares the Lord, I will do to you the very thing I heard you say. So, Proverbs 18:21, life and death are in the power of the tongue. Now, most people, they get excited about the life side of that passage, but there's also a reciprocal. There is the death side of that. And so we've got to realize that. So this was a litmus test, and that is, I'm going to do to you the very thing I heard you say. For sir, those people like Joshua and Caleb said, we're well able to take the land. You're going to get what you said. All those people that said, here's what they really said. I wish we had died in the wilderness. Guess what? That scripture worked for them. Now, I'm going to ask you something tonight. Let's just suppose the Lord's following you around today. Come on now. Y'all look getting a little uncomfortable looking, all right? Because you know he is omnipresent, right? He's everywhere all the time. And he's following us around. I'm going to do to you the very thing I heard you say. So what can we do? We can stir up expectation. So I spoke Sunday a couple of things. One is when you read the word, just like before you eat a meal, most people will pray, believers will pray to observe the Lord and recognize the Lord and give thanks to the Lord. Well, before you go into God's word, why don't you just take a moment, 10 seconds, and just say, Lord, I'm believing this word, the bread of life, is gonna feed me, Lord. Open up the eyes of my understanding. Scripture I like to pray is Luke 24:45, when the Lord Jesus himself opened up their mind so they could understand the scriptures. So just like you pray before you eat natural food, pray before you take the word of God. Jesus said to the people on the road to Emmaus, he said he opened their minds so they could understand the scriptures. Do you believe Jesus can still do that today? Lord, just open up my mind. So here's what I want you to do. When you read the word, we're not just reading for information. We're reading for revelation. We want this word to speak to us. Talk to me today. You know, you can tell people that are hungry. I remember my pastor years ago said he gave his sister a Bible. And she was a new believer. And she just thought, I'm going to start reading with Genesis chapter 1. And he said, I got a hold of her Bible and I looked at it and she had every single verse underlined. You know, she thought, I'm going to underline the good ones. Well, she just underlined the whole chapter. I mean, they're really all good, right? And then he thought that was something. You know, she just was reading it. Oh, that's good. Oh, my Lord, did you read that one? And then look at that. That's a good one, too. And she just, you know, when we read the Word of God, we all need to read it with an expectation. Lord, speak to me. Speak to me. I'm talking about Larry Hutton, but maybe I'm still thinking about his message when he shared on that Sunday morning how the Lord dealt with him about take one scripture, take it to work with you, meditate that scripture, stay on that scripture, stay on that scripture. And, you know, that really spoke to me that morning because I like to spend a lot of time, particularly, you know, in the past year, spent a lot of time in the mornings reading and studying. But it really spoke to me that even though we go wide, it's important that we also go deep. And in my case, I felt like the Lord was really just saying, Tom, you know, you just need to hear and rehear and just drill down deep and tap into that reservoir in those scriptures. And so I encourage you to, as you read the Word of God, don't just be so, I'm in such a hurry to get through this chapter. Well, you need to let that soak in and let that bless you and let it be a refreshment in your life, all right? In the summertime, Sharon, sometimes when I leave the office, she'll say, Tom, will you water the two plants out front? Will you water those two plants out front? And so when I'm leaving, of course, you know, it's been very hot, over 100 degrees some days. And I've learned when you water those plants, even though you have this big pitcher of water, you can't just dump it on there. How many know you have to kind of pour it and then let it soak in, pour a little bit more and let it soak in, pour a little bit more and let it soak in? And that's exactly what happens when our mind is getting renewed to the Word of God. It's the washing of the water of the Word of God. And you know what's happening? We're just pouring that Word in and it just starts kind of soaking in our mind and we start getting our minds renewed to what the Word of God has to say. All right? So number one, you know, mix some faith as you're reading the Word. Now, I heard a preacher say this years ago, and it stuck with me. And he said this, if you're reading the Bible the right way, you'll enjoy it. Does that make sense? Now, if you get over into legalism and all that, you're going to read it, and it's just going to be a weight on you. But if you're reading it the right way, it'll be a joy to you. What does that mean? You just get in there and read. And, you know, for me, I'd get a cup of coffee and just read some. And, oh, boy, that's good. And read some more and read some more. You know, you're just, if you're doing it the right way, it's not a weight on you. It's a joy in your life. So, you know, just read the Word and let it feed you and grow in that. And I encourage you, I know I listen to the Word. Whatever I'm reading, I'll put it on my phone, and a lot of times I'll just listen to the same audio of what I've read. But still, Proverbs 4:29 says, don't let, Proverbs chapter 4 and verse number 20 says this, take heed to the Word of God. Don't let it depart from before your eyes. Keep it in the midst of your heart. For it's life to those that find it. And so you want to let the Word get in your eyes. And I don't know, for me, when if I can see it, it soaks in better. All right? So we talked about that, expectation with that. Then we talked about expectation on all those scriptures that you have committed to memory. You still need to have expectation for them to work in your life. Now, if I went up to most, I could go up to a guy on the street and say to him, I'm going to say the first part of this scripture and you say the second part. You know, I mean a guy, he hadn't been in church all his life, all right? He's broken into a few churches, but he's never been there to worship the Lord. And if I were to look at him and say, the Lord is my shepherd, tell me the last part of that. They'd say, I shall not want. Now, here's what we do sometimes. We think because somebody knows a scripture that they really know a scripture. Does that make sense? Now, I've said this before. Did you know the devil could quote the Apostles' Creed and say, I believe every bit of it? He could sit there and talk about, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. I watched it. He was born of the Virgin Mary. 100% I believe that. He could just go through the Apostles' Creed, and the devil himself would read the Apostles' Creed, hand it back to us, and say, I believe every part of that. But he's not committed to it. He hasn't surrendered to it. He hasn't, you know, made Jesus the Lord of his life. There are people that intellectually can agree with certain things, but because they intellectually agree to certain things, that has nothing to do whether or not it's a reality in their life. Now, here's my point about the 23rd Psalm. A lot of people can quote the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. And we read different translations Sunday morning. You know, I shall lack nothing is one translation. You could have people, you could say that to somebody, then you look at them and say, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. And you know, the next point they talk about is how broke they are, how terrible things are, how life's never working out for them, how nothing works. Y'all, they know it mentally, but when you really know it by revelation, you're not saying the Lord is my shepherd and I'm full of want. You're by faith saying, no, the Lord is my shepherd. Thank you, Lord, you're supplying every need. Thank you, Lord, that I shall not want for any good thing. Amen. So that's what we've got to do. We've got to take these scriptures that we know. Now, I mentioned also Psalm 91. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow. And I kind of impressed y'all. Did I impress you Sunday on my quoting? I tried to, but then I messed up. Did y'all notice that I messed up? But man, I was doing good. I was kind of like the guy water skiing. I was doing good there for a while, and then I wiped out. But anyway, you know, I can impress you with me going through the 91st Psalm. And some of y'all could say, oh, my Lord, my pastor, he knows the 20. See, I already messed up. My pastor knows the 91st Psalm. You should hear him quote it. Y'all, whether I know the 91st Psalm, even while I'm sitting in this building, Whether I know the 91st Psalm is whenever they tell us there's a tornado headed to Yukon, Oklahoma. 10-4. Whether I know the 91st Psalm has to do with Pastor Tom's going on a mission trip and he's going to be going over to some areas that aren't very well protected, that's when you're going to know how much revelation I have on 1,000 may fall at my side and 10,000 at my right hand, but only shalt with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the destruction of the wicked, right? So what I'm trying to get across to you, there's a lot of people that we say, oh, they know that. Oh, they know the word. You know, intellectual knowledge doesn't impress me a whole lot. But people that say, you know what, I know what the word says, and God's going to watch over us. We're going to lock in on the word. We're going to be a doer of the word of God. We know what the word of God says. Now, here's what can happen. You can be deceived in that you think you know more than what you're really walking in. I can be deceived. You know, for example, the 23rd Psalm says, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. And it goes on to say this, I will fear no evil. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Everybody say, I will fear no evil. Now, how many of you knew that verse was in the 23rd Psalm? Do you realize? How many of you say, Pastor, actually, I had heard that before? Okay, some of you aren't voting. How many of you say, yeah, Pastor, I've heard that one. I think I've seen that in the Bible there. Y'all, just because I've seen it and just because I can quote it doesn't mean I'm living it. Does that make sense? And I'm not picking on you. I'm talking to myself. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. The Lord is my shepherd. Now, I'm going to be transparent. I've discovered I help people more when I'm transparent than when I'm impressing them with my quoting scripture ability. All right. Okay, so Sharon and I, sometime back, we were talking, and we were talking about finances. I've shared this before, but I know y'all have never done that at your house, but we did it at our house. Isn't that amazing, you know? So we were talking, and we weren't arguing, but we were just talking about, okay, this is coming up, and that's coming up, and we were like, wow, you know, what about this and this? And we're talking, and we were just kind of covering all the bases. And we were talking back and forth, and then, you know, I kind of went to sleep and it was kind of on a downbeat. Does that make sense? Kind of on the down. And I'm telling you, all night long, the Lord kept talking to me. And it was, I said, the Lord is your shepherd, you shall not want. The Lord is your shepherd, you shall not want. I mean, it was like all night long that scripture was going on through me. I woke up the next morning, I said, honey, Jesus talked to me all night long. And I told her, you know what he said? He said, the Lord, we need to, don't emphasize, the Lord is my shepherd, I'm full of wants. How many know the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want? Now let's look at some other scriptures. They have the ability to put up other translations. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Go to the next one. Let's see what another translation is. Oh, actually, I meant another translation of the same verse. Can we do that? Okay, here's the NIV. The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. I kind of like that. Okay, next one. Let's see if we got another one here for you. The Lord is my shepherd. I have all that I need. It keeps getting better. The Lord is my shepherd. I have all that I need. You know what we've got to do? We've got to not be self-deceived. We've got to realize, you know, it's possible I know something up here, but I'm not really walking in the revelation of it like I need to. So we talked about that. And then the final thing on Sunday morning we talked about, and I'm just kind of recapping a few things. We talked about how in the Bible, you know, we have examples in the scripture of God supernaturally moving on people and God extending, giving them supernatural health. We talked about, you know, the scripture says over there, hast thou not known, hasn't you heard that the God, the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the heavens and the earth, he fainteth not. I'm trying to impress you a little bit here. But it goes on to say, the young men shall utterly faint. Right? Remember that? But it says, but they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. Now hear this. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not get weary. They shall walk and not, hear this, faint. So it's a picture of God coming on his people and doing something that the world's not getting, and that is God's renewing their youth. God's strengthening them. The outer man may perish, but there's an inward man that's getting renewed day by day, and we learn to tap into the strength of the spirit of man. There really should be a huge difference between the people of God and the people that are in the world. I mean, there really should be this huge gap between the world and the church, the world and the body of Christ. It should be, oh my Lord, just like it was in Daniel chapter 1, whenever they tested Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and Daniel and put them on the special diet, and at the end of 10 days, they test them, and they said, they're 10 times smarter. And some would say, well, that's a Hebrew idiom. You know, I've read different commentaries. But whether it's an idiom or not, I still, that group's different than the rest of the group. They're achievers. There's a distinction between those people that live in the land of Goshen and those people that are living out there in Egypt. So what am I doing? I'm putting an expectation on the promise of God that I'm going to walk in Zoe. I'm going to walk in the life of God. I'm going to believe to see the goodness of God in the land of the living. Abundant life. Abundant. Check it out in the Strong's Concordance. It says, hear this, it says superior in quality. Abundant life is superior in quality. So there is a distinction between God's people and the world. God's people have this thing called abundant Zoe working in them. In the world, they don't have it. Well, we want them to have it. I mean, it's not like it's a competition. We want them to have this. But for us, there's an expectation. You know, I'm going to tap into certain things. I'm going to tap into these reserves. I'm going to tap into these abilities. And then I finished up Sunday by saying, have you ever heard one of those good sermons and you wanted to say amen? Y'all remember that part of my sermon? Wayne wasn't here. Well, I told him, Wayne, have you ever heard one of those good sermons and you wanted to say amen, but you think if I say amen, that'll just encourage him to go longer, you know? And we've all been there. Three areas tonight. Mix faith with God's word as you read God's word. Okay? And get rid of that little, well, I can't understand the Bible. Yeah, every time you say that, you just got further out there. Okay? It's not called a concealment. It's called a revelation. God wants to reveal his word to you. Second thing is, I want you to mix faith with God's word as it relates to even scriptures that you've committed to memory. Philippians 4:19, the Lord will, you know, supply all of our need. But you need to be careful that you don't just know it up here, but you don't really have a revelation of it down here. And then the third thing I want you to just key in on, as I'm talking about mixing faith with God's word, you need to tap into this, we call it life in the vine, abiding in the vine. It's the life of God that's inside of you. It's the nature of God that renews your youth, that brightens your intelligence, that helps you make great decisions instead of bad decisions. It's like you have a higher expectation that, Lord, you're going to show me what I need to do here. Cliff Davis is a friend of this church, part of this church for many years, lives up north of town. And he spent a lot of time working by himself. And he said something to Harold McLaughlin one time, and Harold told it to me. And he spent a lot of time working by himself, and he made this statement, oh, I never work alone. You know, people say, well, he worked all day by himself. He goes, no, I didn't. I never work alone. All day long is me and the Lord. And for him, it's not just like I'm trying to, you know, trip you up by throwing that one at you and kind of mess. It for him, no, that's the reality. He's working with me all day long. You know, you need to get to that place where people say, did you eat by yourself today? And go, no, I never eat by myself. Were you by yourself all day? Oh, no, are you kidding me? I had angels all in this house. I had the spirit of the living God. God was me. And people say, oh, pastor, you're just kind of, no, The spirit world is more real than the natural world. You know, it's eternal. This is temporal. So, you know, mix faith with this idea of the redemptive life, of the nature of God that's on the inside of you. And, you know, when you live that way, people can think, well, that you're kind of peculiar, you're kind of out there. But it's just normal. It's heaven life, y'all. You can live on that low level, or you can really live in this higher level, and it's called the life of God. I'm amused. I'm in places of business, and you hear music being played. You know what I'm talking about, music? I'm not talking about gospel music. I tell you, for me, if I were getting a job, and I'm talking about outside of the church, if I had to go get a job, I wouldn't care if I was stacking bricks or if I would. What kind of music am I going to have to listen to all day long? Because how many of you start hearing that stuff and it starts getting in you, and that music, it's soulish, and it starts feeding certain thoughts, and you start taking on, it's a classic illustration of the blind are now leading blind people, all right? And so, you know, you need to be careful. And I tell you, for me, you know, I think of people. I was in a place of business the other day, and they had a radio on. It was the bank. I went into the bank, okay? And I was just in there, and they had a little small radio, and this music's going out all day long. It's funny, I hadn't listened to that kind of music in years, and I'm thinking, they're all the same. I mean, these songs have been around forever. They're not working then, they're not working now. But, I mean, they're listening, and these people are. And you say, Pastor, why are you talking about that? Because I'll promise you this. Hear this. The illustration of the crab in a basket. One crab starts to crawl out of that basket. And all the other crabs say, no, 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 you're not pulling out of that. You're coming down here with us. They all gang up and pull them down. Let me tell you, a lot of that music, you're trying to crawl out of the mully grubs. You're trying to pull out of this self-defeated life. And I tell you, that music just wants to grab you and pull you back down. Y'all, there's a better way to live. There's a better way to live. And it's a living, abiding in the vine. It's living with the life of God in you and tapping into that. And in John 10:10, Jesus said, I've come that you might have life and have it to the full, till it overflows. Quality life, superior in quality. Now hear this, abundant in quantity is the other definition. So God has a great life for us. Can I get a good amen? And I'm not going to preach longer if you say amen, all right? All right. Praise the Lord. Let's all lift up our hands to the Lord tonight. Father, in Jesus' name, Lord, we just put a demand on the promise. And Lord, we just ask you tonight, Father, to help each one of us in this room to begin to mix faith with the Word of God. I pray, Father, that, Lord, we would approach your Word in devotional time with a eagerness to hear from God. Lord, I pray that we would be reminded if we're doing this right, it's not a burden to us, but it's a blessing to us, Father. And Lord, I just pray tonight, Lord, in Jesus' name, that all of us would just be reminded we're abiding in the vine, Lord. There's a vine life flowing in us. The nature of God, the ability of God, the wisdom of God. Hallelujah. Come on, let's just thank him tonight. Father, we thank you tonight, Lord. Speak to us. Speak to me. Oh, Father, we bless you. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Father God. You know, as every head is bowed, every eye closed, this should be something everybody needs to settle. You need to have this reference point in your life to where you know that you know that you know that you know that you fully surrendered your life to Jesus. Just like you know what your birthday is, and you know maybe other significant days in your life, you need to know what day you really surrendered your life to the Lord. You may not remember the calendar day, but you remember the event, you remember the place where you were. If you're here tonight and you've never really said yes to Jesus, fully surrendered your life to Jesus Christ, I'd like to give you the opportunity tonight to do that. And that's when you just say yes to Jesus. You make him the Lord of your life, and you say, you know what? Today is my day of salvation. Every head is bowed, every eye closed. You're here today, and you say, Pastor, I'm here today, and I would like to let this be that day that I said yes to Jesus, that I know that I know that I know that I have eternal life. Every head is bowed, every eye closed. Would you just raise your hand tonight if that's you? And you say, Pastor, that's me tonight. Raise it up high enough where I can see it. Can you do that? Praise the Lord. Right here. You say, Pastor, I want to do that. I want to make that yes decision in my life. All right, now I want everybody to look at it. I'm assuming that everybody's done that. Has everybody done that? Everybody in this room done that? Praise the Lord. Well, that's the most important decision. You say, well, Pastor, everybody in the world's done that. Everybody's made Jesus the Lord. Everybody in Yukon has. You know, I think of Ava over here. Ava, you mind if I tell your age when you came to the Lord? She was 62. 62 years old. She served on the board for Manna Pantry, doing benevolent work. I mean, you know, helping people. Kind, voted for Ronald Reagan. I mean, all the things you would think. One time I got her email address and it was reagan.com. Where'd you get that? She goes, oh, you can buy those, you know. Okay, I didn't know that. I mean, on the outside, people would have looked at her and said, oh, she's saved. But you know, she wasn't saved. She came to church. One of the times Larry Hutton was here, June of, I think, 20, what year? July 5th of 2015, first day here, and guess what? She got saved. Isn't that great? But, you know, if you had looked on the outside, you'd say, well, oh, she's probably saved, but she just doesn't know it. How many of people that are saved know it? That's like saying, oh, Pastor Tom. That's like telling somebody who's married, you know, Marlon's not married. He just doesn't know it. Well, I'm not just trying to be funny up here. I'm trying to... Church, we need to have a passion. There's only two groups in the world. There's the kingdom of light, kingdom of darkness. We were in the Czech Republic this last time. There was this precious lady helping us at this hotel. I mean, she was so helpful. She was so sweet. She was so kind. She was so thoughtful. And I went down and the last night we were there, and I gave her a tract from the Four Spiritual Laws in the Czech language. And I gave that to her, and she just looked at it, and I could tell by the look on her face, it's like, I have no idea what this is about. And I thought to myself, you know, it's one thing when people that are vile and reprobate and hate the name, blaspheme the name of God, when those people die, but don't you just, you don't want anybody dying and going to hell, particularly those people that are just good-hearted people. I just don't know. So we all want to get the word out. Amen.